Okay, so we can start, I think. So hi everyone. Today we have a bit of a strange situation, but hopefully a good situation. So the idea is to do something a little bit different than what we've been doing. And today I decided to piggyback a little bit on a very similar initiative in a different community organized by Stefano Sanvito to my left, I guess, of you guys here in, he was a professor in computational physics here in Dublin. And he has invited Giuseppe Carlio from Flatiron Institute in New York to give an overview on quantum machine learning, which I think should be topical and interesting for everybody. So with that, I'm just going to drop out and we enjoy the seminar.
Okay, thanks a lot, John. So as John said, we'll try something pretty unusual now because we're going to stream on two YouTube channels, on our Machine Learning for Science and on the Quantum Thermodynamics channel of John. So the idea of today is to have a seminar that hopefully interests both the community. So maybe very quickly, we have a big pleasure to have Giuseppe Carlio here, who some of you might know for a number of pretty influential paper in the area of machine learning applied to many body and quantum system in general. Very quickly, Giuseppe is a fellow countryman of mine. He did his undergraduate in La Sapienza in Rome and his PhD in Trieste in Sissa. And then spent some time in both Zurich and CNRS in Paris to end up in this pretty brand new institute in New York that is dedicated mostly to computational science. So I guess without any further ado, I just give you the stage and I'm looking forward to the seminar.
Thank you. Thank you, Stefan and John. So I hope that you can see my screen now.
Yep.
Okay, so thank you for the nice introduction and for having me here today. Hi everybody who's following us today. So what I would like to do is to give a relatively introductory talk about the use of machine learning techniques, so in particular what I call neural network quantum states, to problems in basically many-body quantum science. And at the heart of the problem, the thing that I'm going to address during this talk is really the quantum many-body problem. So what is the quantum many-body problem? Well, the origin of this issue is basically is that if you have an interacting, let's say, quantum many-body state described by a wave function psi, that's what I'm writing here. I hope you can see my pointer. In general, if you have, say, the simplest case where you have spin one half particles, then the wave function of this system of m particles is given by a set of exponentially many coefficients. What I write here, c up up, c down down, etc. So you have 2 to the n, for example, in this specific case, complex value coefficients. So it's clear that the exact wave function is an exponentially large object in which you have to specify all these components one by one in principle. And because of this complexity, because of this exponential complexity in the number of particles, so in this case, in the number of spins, solving interesting problems, for example, solving for the ground state of a given Hamiltonian, let's say solving the Schrödinger equation in this case, or solving the time-dependent Schrödinger equation in this other case, or even solving for, let's say, dissipative dynamics if you have an Euclidean L. So all of these problems, if you want to solve them computationally, they are exponentially hard in the number of particles. So this is true. And my favorite way of visualizing how hard this problem is basically trying to figure how many qubits, if you want, we've been able to store in hardware since the beginning of humanity until the most recent days. So, and you can see that, again, if you consider the requirement in terms of space that you need to store, in principle, all these 2 to the n coefficients, if you go from the ancient Egyptians, so let's say 3,000 years before the current age, up to last year, Summit, the largest supercomputer in the world, you can see that in 5,000 years, we've been able to merely go from storing the wave function, if you want, of 10 qubits up to 54 qubits. So this exponential, despite our exponential increase in the computational capabilities, the actual amount of information that we can store on Arduino is still, on classical Arduino, is still pretty limited. And it's clear that we cannot afford to, for example, even store the wave function of large systems that are relevant, for example, for chemistry or for condensed matter applications. However, the question that we have to ask ourselves, I believe, and on which I will give an answer to this question during my talk is basically, is this complexity truly exponential for physical systems, right? And indeed, I mean, the main issue is that even though these states, so these quantum states, live in this huge, exponentially large, if you want, hyperspace of all possible quantum wave functions, it's clear, or at least the intuition is there, and I think it's pretty reasonable, that only a limited, and I would say an exponentially smaller fraction of this large hyperspace of allowed physical states corresponds to physical states. So this green region is what we will be ultimately interested in. So we won't be interested in describing the most general wave function, but only the wave function that, say, are ground states of local Hamiltonians, or that are the result of the dynamics of some physical Hamiltonian, or you're describing electrons, qubits, or whatever is physically relevant. So it's clear that this is a huge simplification. And in the following, I will mostly address what are classical representations of this corner. So basically, I will try to find parameterizations, if you want, of these physical states that are efficient enough to be used for practical calculations. So one, let's say, very popular class of parameterizations are, let's say, parameterizations that are driven by physics. So for example, there are famous wave functions that people have invented in the past years to describe different phases of matter, for example, Laughlin wave function to describe topological phases, Jastrow wave function to describe correlated electrons, Pfaffians to describe pairing. So there is all sort of physics-inspired wave function that describe pretty accurately some model Hamiltonians, if you want. One issue with this state is that typically you are limited to describing your system only through these model Hamiltonians, and you cannot apply these models directly to, let's say, microscopic and physically realistic systems. So a way to go beyond this is to use representations of the wave function that are instead not based on, let's say, some constrained models, but that are more general. And this is done typically through the path integral representations of this physical space of wave function. So without going too much into the details, but the basic idea of these representations is that what you do is that instead of storing, again, the many-body wave function, you devise a stochastic process that allows you to sample from this wave function, which is the result of the imaginary time projection of a given Hamiltonian. So, for example, imagine that you want to sample from the ground state of this H, right? And the interesting aspect of this representation is that it allows you to find, for example, exactly, so again, without storing, the wave function, the ground state of very large systems that have the property of having a Hamiltonian, which is said to be without sign problem. And indeed, thanks to these strategies, so thanks to these particular representations, we get a handle on a lot of a new class of interesting many-body interacting problems that correspond to the so-called, this is a jargon in the community, stochastic Hamiltonians. So these are Hamiltonians that basically are free of sign problem, so to speak. So they have a special property in the sign elements. But again, this representation of the physical states is in a sense limited. So in the sense that we only cover a limited corner of this larger, if you want, green part of the space, because we are limited to only sign problem-free Hamiltonians. And in this case, for example, we cannot find, in general, the ground state of a lot of the interesting interacting problems, for example, electronic problems, where you have electronic degrees of freedom. In that case, you can show that in most cases, you have a strong sign problem that prevents you to use these techniques exactly. So in order to find other representations of this corner of the Hilbert space of these physical states, people have realized other kind of variational representations which are more flexible than the ones that I described at the beginning. And those are, for example, Mellick-Sporter states. So those, in a nutshell, for those who are not familiar with these techniques, are basically a parameterization that is based on low entanglement. So if I have, for example, a one-dimensional system, and I know that basically my interactions are short range and there is no strong long range order in the system, you can show that actually the ground state of the of this problem can be written exactly and compactly as a product of matrices of a small dimension d. So this is the famous Mellick-Sporter state ansatz for the many body wave function. These wave functions have low entanglement. And indeed, with this class of techniques, with this, in particular with these tensor networks that in 1D correspond to these Mellick-Sporter states, but in 2D can be generalized to what people call PEPs, etc. So we can cover another, if you want, a larger fraction of the Dilbert space of physical states. And this fraction of Dilbert space is characterized typically by low entanglement, especially so. And especially in 1D, you can show, you can demonstrate analytically that you can represent all basically the ground state that satisfy the area law of entanglement. In two dimensions, where PEPs have been introduced for, there are some exceptions to this theorem, and in particular, it's known that, that there are some area law states. So again, states that are in a sense physical that have a well-behaved entanglement that cannot be described efficiently with these tensor network states. So even if you have an area law state in 2D, there are cases where, for example, a PEPs is not enough to describe with a small bond dimension that is not exponentially large. This class of wave function. So again, tensor networks, while they are very successful in one dimensions, for two dimensional systems, for example, they are not, if you want, the ultimate wave function that you need to represent in a compact way the ground set, say, of an interacting Hamiltonian, because of different reasons and because of other reasons that I cannot discuss now. So just as a side remark, in addition to classical representations, there are also quantum representations, in the sense that if you say, okay, but I really don't want to store my wave function, or I really don't want to work with a classical system to describe a quantum system, what I can do is that I can go to Google and ask them to prepare a quantum circuit, or to IBM and prepare a quantum circuit that represents my favorite, if you want, ground state of my given Hamiltonian. And this is the spirit of tunable quantum circuit, which is, if you want, another way of addressing this corner of quantum states that are physical states. So in this case, we do not address them tuning classically variational parameters in a classical representation, but we tune parameters inside a quantum circuit. So for example, the parameter inside the gate that I have here that I call theta. And the philosophy is really that what I can do is that I can try to prepare the ground state of a given Hamiltonian or some target state tuning these parameters theta. However, and this is important also to understand how problematic is the quantum many body problem, even if you have access to a full quantum computer, you can show that this is not enough to describe all possible physical states or even physical states of interest. In particular, there is no easy way, so basically there is no polynomial time way of preparing in general the ground state of a physical Hamiltonian. So in general, it's known, or at least it's widely believed that the preparation time for the ground state of a given interacting Hamiltonian, even on a quantum computer, is exponentially scaling with the number of qubits. And in this case, you know, this yellow value of quantum state preparation spans an important part of these physical states. But again, there are other cases, so again, ground states and even dynamics of interesting states that cannot be efficiently represented even with these quantum circuits. So so it's clear that we have to do, we have to use, you know, all these techniques together in order to attack this very hard problem. And this is where machine learning enters the game. And it's a new way, if you want to attack this very old and outstanding problem from a new perspective. And it's a way, if you want to provide a new approach that is complementary or in some cases alternative to the cases that I was describing before. So why machine learning? So why do we want to use machine learning? So I guess that for those of you who followed some videos, lectures, know already about applications of machine learning to science. But let me give you a small and short introduction, basically to a large extent, and to first order, if you want. The reason why we want to use machine learning is because it is one of the most powerful, if not the most powerful, numerical technique we know of that is able to approximate very high dimensional function. So this is what, in a nutshell, and I mean, this is also somehow a reductive view on what machine learning is, but it's what we will need for today's seminar. So you think of machine learning as a set of techniques to approximate computationally in an efficient way very high dimensional functions. And just to give an example, what are these high dimensional functions? Well, those are basically those that have characterized the success of machine learning since the beginning of deep learning, especially since the beginning of the 2010s. For example, if you look at the problem of speech recognition, so when you talk to your phone and your phone understands what you are telling it, basically, in that case, the function that machine learning is learning, so the function that you are representing with these techniques, is a function that takes as an input your voice, so if you want your waveform of your voice, and translates it into some text. So this is a complex, very complicated high-dimensional function that you can approximate using these techniques. But, going through this series of success of deep learning, you can see that the functions that you can approximate are much more complicated than that. For example, you can even approximate the function that translates from a string of text to another language, so from English to Japanese. So this is at the heart of Google Translate. In the more recent days, and this is what has triggered, for example, especially my attention, it has been devised a series of machine learning techniques that are able to learn high dimensional functions that are extremely complex and that describe, for example, the game playing strategy in the game of Go. So here the function that you want to learn, that you want to represent, is a function that takes the positions on the board and returns the next move you should perform in order to maximize the chance of winning your game. So in machine learning, we are learning all these high dimensional functions, and these kind of applications, these kind of ideas are general enough that they can be used in all sort of other domains of science. So I won't go through all the applications, but if you're interested in a review that we recently wrote for Review of Modern Physics, here we show basically how these ideas, so basically how these techniques that are based on approximating these high dimensional functions can be used in all sorts of domains, from statistical physics to particle physics to more recently quantum physics. So let's go in the case directly straight to the heart of the problem, so to the quantum many body problem. Let's go back to our original issue, where, as I was telling you before, the issue is that we have this high dimensional object, if you want, this high dimensional function, which is the many body wave function. So again, what I'm writing here are the many body amplitudes of a given wave function. So here I'm considering some given quantum numbers, S1 up to Sn. I have, let's say, n particles. This can be spins, degrees of freedom. This can be also electronic degrees of freedom. It doesn't really matter. But the main idea that we put forward in this paper, 2016, is that we can describe or we can write a variational, if you want, parameterization of this object in terms of a neural network. So a neural network, a deep network, is really the way that most of the deep learning, machine learning community uses to parameterize these very high dimensional functions that I was discussing before. And what we are doing is basically exactly the same. We take a deep network to parameterize the amplitudes of the wave function. So in a nutshell, what a deep network is just a cascade of nonlinear functions that I call here G, interleaved with linear functions that are these filters WL until you reach the input stage that is S. So S is basically a vector of my quantum numbers. I apply a linear transformation W, then a nonlinear transformation G, linear, nonlinear, until I reach the output of my network. And in this case, the output of my network is just one number. In particular, in general, for a wave function, it will be a complex number that will describe the specific amplitude of my many body wave function. So, and in practice, the variational parameters that you have in this representation are these W, so these weights, and also, of course, the structure of the network. So, basically, how many layers you put, L, and the more layers you put, the deeper the network is in the the parlance of deep networks. And the more weights you have, basically, the wider the network will be. So just to give you a flavor in terms of quantum information theory of what kind of properties you can expect from this parameterization of the wave function, there's been a lot of interesting papers that followed up our first work, where people have studied some of the main properties of this representation of the many-body wave function. For example, it has been shown that you can easily represent volume law entanglement, so not only area law entanglement, but also volume law entanglement efficiently. So efficiently means with polynomially many parameters in these neural networks, as opposed to, for example, to standard tensor networks. You can also show that if you have a deep network, so for example, a convolutional neural network that is very popular in image recognition systems, you can show that these kind of architectures are very efficient at describing entanglement because you can basically use the depth of the network to encode a lot of long-range correlations between different parts of your quantum systems. Also, there have been other cases where people have written, or if you want, they have connected to the first family of wave function that I was describing. So basically, it is the physics-inspired wave function. So like Jastrow wave function, Laughlin wave function. And in this case, indeed, there have been several papers. I'm only citing two of them here, but there's a lot more, where people have shown that all these families of states basically have exact and efficient representation in terms of simple neural networks that can be written. For example, representations of the ground state of the toric code or Jastrow states, etc. There's also a connection with Maddox water states. So this is again in the spirit of the other family of states that I was introducing at the beginning. In particular, you can show that in general, so shallow networks of this RBM restricted Boltzmann machine form, this is just a deep network with only one hidden layer. So basically these correspond, in the worst case, to Maddox product states that have exponentially large bond dimensions. So this, the size of the matrices that you have in that case, in the worst case, is exponential in the size of the, basically, in the number of sites that you have. So this is one worst case mapping. The inverse mapping has not been done completely at the moment, but it's something that I will discuss towards the end of this talk. So concerning the applications, there is several things that you can do with this representation of the wave function. So the one that I'm going to discuss more prominently during this talk is about simulating quantum systems. And I will tell you in a moment what I mean by that. There is, however, a whole zoo, if you want, of other applications that you can do that are instead driven by experimental data, where, for example, you want to reconstruct the wave function of a given system, given some observables. I'm not going to discuss about this application during this talk, but if you want, you can have a look at our work here from 2018. What I'm going to do today is that I'm going to give you an overview about how we can use this representation to simulate quantum systems without any external knowledge, if you want, or if you want any pre-solved problem. So we just assume that we know, let's say, the Hamiltonian, or we know the physical problem we want to solve, but we don't make any assumption on having already solved, if you want, the problem beforehand. So this is, in my opinion, very crucial to have a successful machine learning application to science. So if you assume that you have already solved the problem, then it's not very interesting to use another technique that if you already have a solution to that problem. So in this case, we are aiming at solving a problem that we don't know how to solve with other techniques. And the problems that we want to solve, we attempted solving, are solving for the ground state, let's say we're given Hamiltonian, and again, the only input here will be the Hamiltonian or the unitary dynamics. So here we want to find the time evolution of a given state or even the time evolution of a given quantum circuit if you are in the context of quantum information. So there's a paper where we do this. Or more recently, you can extend these approaches also to study the time evolution of density matrices. So this is a lot of work. I'm not going to talk about this, but I will mostly focus, unless there are questions later, on this aspect of the story, which is also already pretty intricate and complex, which is basically finding ground states of given Hamiltonians for different kind of systems. So how do we do that? Well, basically, I mean, I've told you that we have a parameterization of the wave function in terms of these weights, so in terms of these neural network weights, W. So what we can do is that we can just write a variational formulation of the ground state problem, where basically, instead of solving the eigenvalue problem for psi, we minimize, we transform the eigenvalue problem into an optimization problem. So we write the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, and we know, by virtue of the variational principle, that this object is larger than the exact ground state energy. You can show, and this is due to the pioneering work of Macmillan in the 60s, that you can write this quantum expectation value into a stochastic expectation value that I've written here over a probability distribution, which is what I call psi square of S. So S now is my ensemble of quantum numbers. Of an object which in literature is called the local energy. I'm not writing here the explicit form of this object, but it's very easy to work out. So basically, the insight of Macmillan was that we can write this quantum expectation value as a statistical expectation value, and then we can use all the techniques, for example, from Monte Carlo, from sampling techniques, to evaluate these many-body expectation values stochastically. And indeed, once you have this mindset, you can also rephrase all sort of other quantities. So in particular, the gradient also of the energy with respect to the parameters in the network in terms of stochastic expectation values, again, over this probability distribution, which is the modulus square of my wave function. And in particular, again, I'm not going into the details, but you can rewrite also the energy gradient in terms of basically a covariance of this local energy with some other objects that I call OK, which are nothing but the derivative of the wave function with respect to my variational parameter. One of the main differences, I would say, with respect to standard machine learning techniques, at least up to now, is that we do not use, once we have the gradient, if you want, of the energy, we don't use standard, first-order techniques like the stochastic gradient descent or other objects that are very fashionable and very widely used in supervised learning. But for these applications, is better to use what in our community is known as the stochastic reconfiguration method, devised by Sandro Sorella in the 1990s. Amazingly enough, in the community of machine learning is also known as an optimization method, but it is known with a very different name, and it's called the natural gradient method, devised by Amari more or less at the same time. And the amazing thing is that this two techniques are stochastic optimization techniques devised for very different reasons. So Sandro was not using neural networks at the time, but other wave functions. And basically, they were devising the same technique, and these two communities didn't know about each other until very recently, when we discovered this connection between basically the world of variational Monte Carlo, which is these techniques where we optimize wave functions stochastically, and the world of machine learning, deep learning, where people use also very similar techniques to optimize stochastically high-dimensional functions. So in a nutshell, this technique is a second-order method where we approximate, somehow we have an approximation for this, for a second-order-like method where we use an approximation of the Fisher information matrix to somehow precondition the gradient G. I won't go into the details, but if you're interested, you can write me or we can discuss later about this. So let me give you now an example application of these techniques to show basically how well or how bad they perform in real-world cases. One benchmark that we've been using a lot and that also people are using at this point to somehow establish how good these wave functions are in the context of spin models, for example, are frustrated two-dimensional spins. So this is a class of condensed matter, if you want, models, where you have a Heisenberg-like interaction. These are exchange terms between nearest neighbors, let's say on a square lattice, with some constant J1, and then you have the same term, but exchanging on the diagonals of the square lattice with another intensity J2. And basically, you can show that this model is frustrated in the sense that there is a competition between these two terms, J1 and J2. Indeed, when J2 is negligible, you stabilize an antiferromagnetic phase, where you basically have up, down, up, down, up, down. So this is the cartoon in this phase, so this null order phase. And instead, in the other limit, when J2 is dominating over J1, you stabilize a striped order where you have a columnar order alternating all up and all down, etc. So the question that has been open, and which is to some extent also relevant for high temperature superconductivity models, is whether we have in the middle some disordered spin liquid phase. So basically a phase that does not that is not ordered, long range ordered like these two phases, and it is generally disordered at zero temperature, so because of this competition. So this question is still open, and this is one of those models that are hard to solve because you cannot use basically the path integral techniques that I was discussing because you have strong same problem. You cannot use efficient tensor network approaches because you are in two dimensions and you have to make some approximations. And basically, this is we don't know apart from small systems the exact ground state of this Hamiltonian. So this is a natural playground, let's say, for our techniques. So what we did is that we used what we call convolutional quantum states. So these are again basically the ideas that you take a convolutional neural network, which is where these filters W that I was discussing at the beginning are taken to be local, so they have some finite range here, and you stack a lot of them, cascading them with some nonlinear functions in the middle. The important property, if you look at this in terms of wave function of this kind of representations, is that they are translational invariant. So in particular, if you take these filters to be the same within the same channel, so basically you can show that the output of these networks is the same if you translate your spins by a lattice vector. And this is relatively important if you want, for example, to have if you are studying a system which is with periodic boundary conditions. So let me give you some flavor how well these things work. So in the Heisenberg limit, so where J2 is equal to zero, in the first works we were already, so this is the error on the energy that we can compare to in this case with path integral methods. So basically increasing the size of the network, that in this case is parameterized by this single number alpha, you can reduce the error that you have on the energy quite substantially. You can improve also on what at the time were state of the art results obtained with PEPs. But more recently, again, using these mildly deep networks like these convolutional neural networks that I showed you, you can further improve this this accuracy and go here. I will show you later that we can also do much better than this. But coming back to the problem, this J1, J2 problem, apart from the energy, we can also compare to basically other properties. So here I'm comparing the structure factor. So this is a quantity that is that along pi pi will be finite in the L order, and along pi zero will be finite in the striped phase. And basically, you can see that also if you compare these two exact diagonalization on the size that you can do with VD, we have a pretty good accuracy in terms of what you can obtain with our neural networks. Just to give you a flash of what is the state of the art at the moment of our approaches, basically, if you compare the energy in this case on a 10 by 10 cluster of our approach compared to other techniques, you can see that there is a large region of this diagram as a function of J2, where these neural network quantum states outperform other techniques. There is only at the moment a small region in the middle, so where J2 is of order 0.5, where we find that the MRG approaches are still more accurate than our techniques, even in this two-dimensional geometry. But this is, again, the first work where we use these techniques, and I think that there is a lot of room for improvement. Indeed, one of the main reasons why we have this lack of accuracy in the middle is because our ansatz is not SU2 invariant, so we do not preserve SU2 symmetry like the original Hamiltonian should do. We only preserve translational symmetry, and this is basically this is what you can see here, because S square should be zero everywhere in the ground state, but it's not zero. However, recently there's been a very interesting paper by Tom Vieira and Frank Restrade and the other collaborators, where they showed how to integrate these symmetries also in the neural networks. And I believe that using these techniques will be possible to basically also improve the accuracy in this point, and I think eventually have the most accurate state-of-the-art results on this model everywhere in the phase diagram, and not only on these points here. Okay, so the time is running relatively fast, I will give you a very quick flavor of this more advanced class of states that we are using, that belong to this family of computationally tractable states. So for those of you working in quantum information, there is this fantastic paper by Van den Nest from 2009, where he defines what a computationally tractable quantum state, classical state if you want, is, classical parameterization of a quantum state is. And basically, this is a state that has two properties. So the first one is that you can sample efficiently from the amplitude, so from psi square of x, so this probability distribution, where x is a given bit string, or is a set of quantum numbers. And the other property is that you can compute efficiently the overlaps, basically, between the psi and the given bit string. Again, both things in polynomial time. Then what Van den Nest showed is that under these assumptions, you can compute any observable in polynomial time, any interesting local observable in polynomial time over this wave function psi. This is important because most of the states that I've discussed before are not classically computationally tractable. So, for example, if you take this Jastrow wave function or other variational animals that have been studied in the past, those are not computationally tractable in the sense that they break this first condition. So, in particular, it's not possible to. Is there an issue? Sorry.
No.
Okay, sorry.
No, looks okay, Giuseppe.
Okay, sorry. Okay, so basically they break one of the this condition A. So basically you can't sample efficiently from this wave function, And also in general deep networks do not satisfy this condition, so you cannot sample efficiently. So this means that you have to devise some heuristic, some Markov chain, etc., to sample from these states. Instead, more recently, we've introduced a class of new wave functions that are also deep networks that satisfy also the first property. So it is possible to sample from these states efficiently without using Markov chain Monte Carlo, for example. And these are what we call the autoregressive quantum states. So these are parameterization of the wave function that are somehow taken and inspired by probabilistic models using deep learning. So I won't go too much into the details of this, but just tell you that we use what is called in the literature these masked convolutional neural networks. So at the end, instead of taking these full filters, you zero out some of the waves in the filters. And by doing so, you are able to devise a wave function that allows you to efficiently sample from it without doing Markov chain Monte Carlo, for example. Basically, because you can compute all the marginals of these spins distribution exactly. Again, I will not go into the details, but I will show you that thanks to this technological advance, if you want, we've been able also to use much deeper networks that we could use at the beginning of this story. So basically, at the beginning, we could use networks with a few thousand parameters, but now, removing this bottleneck, we can go up to even easily 1 million or a few millions parameters, and we can achieve also better accuracies. So for example, if you look at the original benchmark that I was showing you, so this is the Isomerc model, which is a non-trivial benchmark for many interacting problems. Basically, you can see that using these deeper networks, so these autoregressive neural network states, we can further improve the accuracy down here. So you can see that the scale is also different, and we can solve basically exactly the ground state of this model, which is non-trivial in 2D, because again, this is a highly strongly interacting quantum wave function. And finding a compact representation of it with this high accuracy in two dimensions was and is to some extent still an outstanding problem. Now, the other application that I will discuss in the, maybe in the next few minutes is what we are doing and what other people are doing for fermions. So up to now, I've been describing a lot spin systems. But I guess that some of the audience is interested also in fermionic problems. So where basically my essential degrees of freedom are not spins, but are let's say fermionic occupation numbers or fermionic coordinates. So the beginning of the story basically is that there has been some first approaches where people have used some, let's say, neural networks and they multiply them to determinants. So this is a super just sort of approach that I won't go too much into the details. This approach was limited at the time because they were taking only positive neural network quantum states that were multiplying a correlated fermionic state. So in principle, you could not extrapolate when alpha was going to infinity, so when the network was going to a large number, to the exact result in this case, because you were enforcing the wave function to be positive. Whereas we know that the fermionic wave function can change sign, especially when you have strong correlations. Somehow the newer approaches to this problem that have emerged, I would say, very prominently at the end of last year. For example, there is a very interesting work by Google DeepMind in collaboration with William Folks, and also in the group of Frank Noe in Berlin, where they basically use a parameterization of the wave function in terms of...
Giuseppe, can I ask you just to stop just for 2 seconds? Because yes. The bit rate is coming and going. It was perfect up until now. But maybe we can just see if I can stop and start streaming on my side. So apologies to people on Stefano's side. Just let's see if I can sort that out.
Okay.
And I'll tell you when to go again. Apologies, everyone. It happens sometimes. So many people are working from home at the moment that. 2 seconds, sorry. Yeah, I don't know. I just stopped the streaming for a second. It's better. Okay, so I'm gonna start the streaming again. Okay, and I'll tell Giuseppe to continue. So start streaming. Okay, it's starting to stream. Wait a second, Giuseppe. Sorry. Apologies, everyone. It was perfect up until now. I don't know what happened.
Okay, so can I?
2 seconds. Is it okay, Francesca? 2 seconds. Okay. Okay, go for it, Giuseppe. Sorry about that.
No problem. So as I was mentioning, I was about to describe some applications now that are more recent to Fermionic, even more recent to Fermionic systems. I was mentioning that the challenge here is really describing the wave function of a fermionic system using a neural network in an efficient way. Right? So one of the techniques that approaches that have been put forward last year, in September last year, are from Google DeepMind group here, and also from Frank Noyes group in Berlin. And the idea is that you take a slither determinant of some orbitals that are take into account not only that are not single particle orbitals, but that are also many body somehow orbitals, where this phi, so they depend also on all the other particle coordinates, and this phi are neural networks. So basically, you take a slither determinant or a linear combination of slither determinant, as in this case, where the orbitals are not single particle orbitals, but they are orbitals that are backflow orbitals, that they're called in jargon, where these phi are parameterized by a neural network. And this is a very general strategy, if you want, that was done also before, not with neural networks, but with similar approaches. For example, in this paper by Marco Saltzman and co-workers. But really, we've seen this year that we can use neural networks to approximate these objects. So this is one approach that works directly in continuous space. So our approach that we also put forward at the same time is a bit different, and is based instead on using directly this discrete, if you want, representation of the wave function that I was showing at the beginning. So just to cut the long story short, what we do is that this is a working collaboration with Antonio Mezzacapo at IBM and Kenny Chu in Zurich, University of Zurich. What we do is that we just we map our fermions to spin degrees of freedom. So the simplest way of doing that is the Jordan-Victor mapping, as you know. So basically, you just take a fermionic operator and you transform it into, so this is the formal mapping, you transform, let's say, a C operator into a sigma minus through this string of sigma Z. Once we have our favorite, let's say, if you want, many body spin Hamiltonian that is derived from these rules, we can use our spin neural network states. For example, we've done we've used this approach to study some relatively small, small molecules in some finite basis sets that are popular among quantum chemists. What you can see here is basically the energy dissociation profile for a couple of molecules. So this is C2, this is N2, nitrogen and carbon. And you can see that our results that are in this case, this green lines are RBN. basically lie on top of the FCI. So this is the exact solution that you can obtain with full configuration interaction results. And they typically improve on these small basis sets on the, let's say, coupled cluster or coupled cluster with triplets. So this is especially true, I mean, if you see here for these two molecules, we improve with relatively small networks upon these approaches. We've also used different mappings. I won't go into the detail because there are, in general, different ways of mapping fermions to spins. For example, using this Brabic-Itaif mapping, in practice, we see that it doesn't really matter too much what mapping we use, but somehow the Jordan-Wigner mapping is also the one that is more accurate in most cases. So the basically the take-home message of this is that if we take these small molecules in again basis states that are not super large yet, so admittedly this is still the beginning of the story, but still in these basis sets and for these molecules, we clearly see that our results are at the level of basically FCI, and we improve systematically on also on the couple cluster with triplets, which is by many considered the state-of-the-art approach for this kind of chemistry applications. Again, the problem here is that while we are able to capture very efficiently all sort of correlations, so, the issue that we have is that when we want to use this approach with larger basis sets, typically we need to use also a lot more samples that we can typically afford. And this is a limitation we are trying to somehow, so you can see here the dependency of the energy with the number of samples that we use in this stochastic procedure. And you can see that the energy systematically goes down, but you see that at some point we have to stop. And this is one of the limitations that we are trying to solve right now, that it's not essential, an essential limitation that most likely can be also overcome in the next iterations of this work. Okay, so just a final word is about the software. All of this is typically something that you don't want to implement from scratch yourself, and luckily enough, we have a library to do that. So this is NETCAT. This is an open source ongoing project in Python. Result of a large collaboration. If you want, you can just connect here, get your the software, and possibly get started with your quantum favorite quantum problem. And in general, so these are this is my outlook for today's talk. I would say that at this point, and you know, after 3 years since introduction of these neural network states, I would say that we've convinced a lot of skeptics that we can already obtain and in some cases improve upon state-of-the-art results in a lot of different systems, so ranging from spin systems to electronic systems to dynamics that I haven't discussed here. And also, so this is, I think, something that is somehow an important point also for the future. But there's a lot of open questions, a lot of challenges where there's really need for new forces. One of those is related, for example, finding a meaningful measure of the complexity of these quantum states that is not the entanglement entropy. So as I was mentioning at the beginning, entanglement entropy is an important quantity to characterize, for example, how complex a tensor network is. So in particular, if you have entanglement entropy, the number of parameters in the tensor networks are many. However, in our case, we don't have this one-to-one correspondence, and it's largely believed that entanglement entropy is not a good quantity to quantify how hard it is to simulate a quantum system using these neural network states. And in general, I think that finding, as a community, finding a meaningful measure of classical simulation complexity that is beyond entanglement entropy, that is meaningful for a lot of other states rather than tensor networks only, is one of the most interesting and intriguing challenges out there. Another one is, that basically in these chemistry problems, we would like to go beyond these sampling issues that I was discussing. This is a bit technical, but if you want, we can discuss about this later. And let me just conclude saying that I think that in the future, we will also explore more and more what are the limitations somehow of these neural network states and how large is the fraction of this physical state that they can cover. At the moment, this is still an open question, but we have a proof that is going to appear soon that shows that basically all efficiently usable tensor networks are a subclass of these neural network states, so including MPS and contractible PEPs. So I think that in this sense, neural network states are a more general classical description of quantum wave functions. And also, this is a conjecture that is not proved, but I think that can be proved. I think it should be possible to show that also the neural network states entail and somehow are a larger class than what I would call a QMC state, so these path integral states that can be obtained upon exact sampling without some problem using this path integral formalism that I was discussing at the beginning. So I think that in the future we will explore most of these connections in more detail, but I would say that at the moment there is certainly quite some optimism in the fact that these kind of simple descriptions are, however, relatively powerful and they can encompass a lot of other existing variational or non-variational states. So thank you.
Thanks a lot, Giuseppe. Stefano there.
Thanks a million, Giuseppe.
Stefano, it was a good job that we had two different channels because towards the end, my one really collapsed.
Yeah.
So I transferred people over to your side.
Yeah, at some point, the number of people doubled somehow. Okay.
Okay, I leave you ask the questions, so okay. I'll drop out.
So first of all, there is a lot of people clapping their hands on the dashboard, which I guess means that there was a lot of appreciation. So I have a couple of questions. So let me read them. The first one is from Joshua Heath. I'm sorry, I don't know where you are, but thanks for asking the question. So the question is, a large problem in strongly correlated material is when a Landau quasi-particle exists. And so the question is, can you potentially use machine learning to better understand when and where a Landau Fermi liquid exists in a given system?
Yeah, so I would say that this is what you can do with all sort of strongly correlated approaches to strongly correlated systems. So basically, in principle, if you are able to solve ab initio, so to speak, the model Hamiltonian, then you can compute all sort of quantities and try to understand if they agree with Landau theory or not. So, for example, you can take the upper model and see if you find a quasi-particle weight, which is somehow related to what you expect from quasi-particle theory and all of that. So I would say that this is all sort of things that you can do quite efficiently once you have a wave function for the system, yes.
And another question from Rajesh Tiwari is in my own group. Is essentially asking, so if you take fermions and spin system in general, they don't have the same commutation rule. So how you go by doing this mapping?
Yes, so basically we use this, so there are different ways of doing that. So, and this is also the reason why we collaborated a little bit with IBM about this. And this is the same problem that they solve when they want to simulate fermions on a quantum computer. So on a quantum computer, you have basically only spin degrees of freedom, qubits, and you want to map your fermionic Hamiltonian, onto a spin Hamiltonian. So the simplest way is to use the time-honored Jordan-Wigner mapping. So basically, you transform this C dagger onto this sigma minus and C up into a sigma plus operator. And the trick is that you transform these local operators, local fermionic operator, into a non-local, if you want, string of spin operators. So you transform your local fermionic Hamiltonian into a non-local spin Hamiltonian that takes into account the anti-commutation rules.
Thank you.
The other trick that you can do is you can do this gravity dark mapping. I mean, there is all sort of other mappings that people have devised, especially in this quantum computing business.
Another question from Ilya Kite is asking, could you please comment on the pros and cons of the RBM over convolutional neural networks?
Yes. So RBM are these, I didn't discuss them explicitly, but they are basically a version of these neural networks that we used in the first works, where instead of taking all these layers, so let's say in this convolutional network, you take only one basically layer. So these are, let's say, shallow networks, and it's clear that there is a certain an advantage in using convolutional neural networks, deep neural networks, over these shallow RBMs. So these results, for example, were obtained with these shallow networks. As soon as you branch on the depth, you can improve on the accuracy. And I was showing you towards the end that going even deeper, so depth around 10 or I think or 20, but in this case, you can further improve the accuracy. So the idea is that if you have a deeper network, you can more efficiently encode most properties of the quantum system, yes.
Okay. Another question is, the neural network state are dense in the Hilbert space. Is there something similar in tensor neural network states?
So neural network states are dense in the sense that there is a universal representation theorem that guarantees you that you can write any state using these neural networks. Of course, it doesn't tell you how many neurons you need. And in the worst case, it's still an exponentially large amount of neurons. So there's nothing, there's no way around that, if you want. But in practice, you see that using polynomially sized networks, we can describe efficiently a lot of interesting physical problems. So, sorry, what was the other part of the question?
If there is anything similar for the conjecture for tensor neural network. Sorry, tensor network states.
For tensor networks. Yes.
Sorry, tensor state, yeah.
Okay, so for tensor networks in 1D, they are known to be universal also, yes. And in 1D, you can show that the embedded border state is universally, you can describe universally all gapped ground states of Hamiltonians efficiently. But the same argument, this is a proof that will appear soon from us, applies also to neural networks. So a neural network for a one-dimensional problem can describe efficiently all gapped ground states, basically.
Okay, we have another question from Mauro Paternoso from Queens in Belfast. And the question is, can I turn the problem around and wonder if for the given quantum state, a quantum machine learning approach could find the Hamiltonian that such state as the ground state?
Yes, so this is the kind of inverse problems that people are studying ourselves. We are also playing with some of these inverse approaches. In general, yeah, you can devise somehow a parent Hamiltonian, typically numerically, that corresponds to the exactly the parent Hamiltonian of a given neural network state. Within numerical error. Unfortunately, there's not a straightforward analytical procedure to do that, but it would be nice, if we had one, at least for simple neural network states.
We have another question from Leonardo Benini, and he's asking, are there any successful known works or promising direction regarding other deep learning architecture, like recurrent neural networks or so on?
Yes. Yeah, that's an excellent point. So there has been a recent paper by Juan Carasquilla, where they use a recurrent neural network thing. Well, I'm not sure they actually use maybe they didn't use a recurrent neural network. But what I wanted to say is that there is a lot of research activity in using more modern, architectures. In particular, for example, these autoregressive deep networks that I was discussing before. And this is the case where you can, where basically we are using some of the, things that were introduced in the community in 2016 or 17, so something much more recent than RBMs, so to speak. And these kind of networks are very important because they allow us, for example, to sample exactly from the wave functions instead of doing a Monte Carlo sampling. So yes, there is a lot of efforts in this direction. So in the specific case of recurrent neural networks, I would say that I think there's nothing published, but most likely there will be.
And okay, so I see another couple of questions. So the first one is a follow-up question from Ilya, and say, how does any one know that by increasing the network depth, you don't overfit?
Yes, so this is a legitimate question. So the answer is that this is not a supervised problem. So in general, we don't have a data set. So we don't have, we are not doing supervised learning. So we don't have the wave function that we are trying to learn. So we want to find the wave function ourselves. So in this sense, what we do is that at each step, we generate new samples. New sample. So this means that it is basically virtually impossible to overfit, in the sense that we are not reusing the same data set over and over. We are generating new data at every step with the new wave function that approximates better and better our ground state. So this is, again, in contrast with supervised learning, where instead you have a data set.
And the other question I see here, is it possible to approach the full CI limit describing the electron state of a chemical molecule with neural network states?
Yeah, so this is what we started doing here. And basically, the full CI limit is the, yeah, it's this line. I don't know if you can see it, but basically this red line, and we are a little bit, over that. I mean, not too far from it. For this specific basis and for these specific molecules. So I would say that, yes, it is possible. The question is, this is still wide open. We don't know what are the better architectures to do this job. Here we were using, again, very simple-minded one-layer RBMs, so, the simplest networks you can think of, and still you can get very close. I guess that if you use deeper networks and you solve these sampling issues that I was mentioning briefly, you will be most likely able also to achieve this full CI limit, to better position that you get here.
Maybe Giuseppe, I don't see any other question on the chat, so I can use my super user authority and to ask a question myself. I just wonder, so particularly if you look at ground state property, of doesn't matter how complex is your many-body system, you can always work in a density functional type of approximation, also for lattice network and all that. Do you think this can be an alternative? Because in reality, for the ground state, you don't need to know the wave function if this is what you're looking for.
Right. So okay. So I mean, this is the this is a different philosophy, if you want. Yeah, by Walter Kohn. Was mentioning that the wave function is somehow something a monster that we shouldn't even consider in the first place, and we should only look at the density functional, if you want. So no, I mean, this is a legitimate position, but this position, I think, is somehow driven by the fact that it is often in some sense misunderstood that if we want to work with wave functions, we need to work with the exponential complexity of the wave function. But my point is that by reducing the wave function, which is an exponentially object, largely object, to a polynomial large object, we are effectively already reducing this complexity, and working with this reduced complexity, it's to some extent like working, not exactly, of course, but working with a simpler, let's say, density functional approach. And also, this is the only way I know of to still have a variational property that is very well verified. Because if you start parameterizing density functionals, I mean, one of the issues that you might encounter is that it's not clear how to guarantee the variational property, for example, in that case. Unless you want to learn it from data, but that's a different story. Right. And there's a lot of people are doing that too.
And maybe okay, so I see, let's say this is the last question from Natalia Ares from Oxford. Do you see scope for hybrid approach of a mix of neural network and physical aware approaches?
Yeah, that's an excellent point, and I think that that would be the future of some of these things that I was discussing. Again, I was mentioning at the beginning that this machine learning will work at its best when combined also with other things. Indeed, if you start combining our convolutional states, for example, with some Pfaffian or some other wave function for strongly correlated systems, you can already see, and there have been, and there will be more works in this direction, that you can increasingly improve your results by a large amount. So I think that yes. So this is if you have some prior knowledge, if you want, or if you have some physical understanding of your system beyond the symmetries that we are already including, then you should use that. This is clear. Yeah. So you should just go blindsided. You should always try to use the best of your knowledge. Yeah.
Okay, so thanks a lot. I mean, I guess, John, unless you have any other questions, maybe we can stop the streaming here.
No, I mean, maybe I was just going to say that if there's people left from my side watching on this side, apologies for the technical issue. The streaming was absolutely perfect up until the last 15 minutes or so. But thank God we had a backup with Stefano in the background. But we'll download the full stream from Stefano's channel and put it up to our one. So if anybody missed out, we have it there. And that's all I want to say. Giuseppe, thanks very much for a great talk.
So
Thank you.
clearly the streaming in County Wicklow is worse than in County Dublin.
What can you do? You know, I mean, we're outside of the technological place, you know, here in the countryside, you know.
So anyway, so thanks Giuseppe again, and thanks all of you out there for listening.
Thank you. Take care. Stay safe. Bye-bye.
Cheers.